Hello, this is Dale Wetzel. I'm the host of the Legislature Today radio show. We're broadcasting this evening, tonight, live from the Peacock Alley in downtown Bismarck. The Peacock Alley is a bar and restaurant, and they serve all manner of victuals, and also they serve beverages to make you feel better after a hard day. And let me tell you about their specials this evening if you happen to be in Bismarck and are inclined to visit a bar and restaurant this evening. We have a dollar off BAMS. Now, BAM is an acronym. It stands for big. Well, the B stands for big, and the M stands for mug. And A stands for a three-letter word that describes one's posterior. And so you have a dollar off a large quantity of beer, for example. You can enjoy that at the Peacock Alley Bar and Grill. And you also have $1 off hamburgers, which are quite excellent, as I am here to tell you from firsthand experience. First of all, we want to introduce our guests for this evening. We're going to be, in the first half hour of the show, we're going to be talking about a bill that will help North Dakota hospitals, particularly those in western North Dakota, recoup some of their bad debt losses from patients who come in and are treated for injuries sustained on the job sometimes. And they're treated for injuries and they can't pay their bills or skip out on their bills. The problem of bad debts at western North Dakota hospitals in particular has become quite an acute problem. We're going to be discussing that issue with three gentlemen who are with us this evening. They are Representative Rick Holman. He's a Democrat from Mayville. We have Senator John Andrist, who is a Republican from Crosby, and he represents the northwestern corner of North Dakota, where a great deal of oil development is going on. And we also have Representative John Nelson, a Republican from Rugby. We'll speak to these three gentlemen in a moment. First, let me tell you about what went on in the legislature today. Some capsule summaries of things that happened. One of the things that happened today is that the House defeated a proposal to raise the cigarette tax from 44 cents a pack to a dollar a pack. Now, this lost 72-19. It lost rather decisively. This would have raised about $60 million in new revenue. And we'll talk about this later because the bill that I referred to earlier, the bad debt relief bill for hospitals, will get its money from tobacco tax revenues. The cigarette tax in North Dakota hasn't gone up since 1993. And the last serious attempt to raise it was a decade ago by John Hoeven, who was the governor at the time. At the time, the state budget was in a bit more serious straits than it is now. That's putting it mildly. And even then, the legislature, which was controlled by Republicans, was reluctant to raise a tax of any kind. And the proposal by the governor to raise the cigarette tax was defeated. The North Dakota House also defeated a bill that was kind of notable in that it would have given workers' compensation benefits to first responders as compensation for their mental injuries as that might have occurred when they came upon a particularly traumatic or graphic medical situation. Workers' compensation benefits are not normally paid for mental injuries. They're paid for physical injuries. If you break your arm, you get work on the job, you get workers' compensation. If you see something horrific and are affected mentally by it, you don't get workers' compensation. This was an attempt to extend workers' comp benefit to a particular situation where someone suffered a mental injury, particularly first responders who turn up at a particularly horrific accident or emergency that they have to respond to as part of their job. Well, this was defeated as well. The governor signed a bill today, his second bill of the session. It is a $720 million highway road construction bill This will provide $600 million for Western North Dakota during the next 2 years. The reason this is notable is that budget bills normally take effect in July of the year that the legislature meets. This bill is intended to give a jump start to road construction this spring because it's been passed by the House and Senate by unanimous margins. And there was no objection to the bill, and it had an emergency clause, which means it goes into effect immediately. The governor signed the bill, so this bill is in effect. There's going to be $720 million available tonight for spending on road construction and repair. $600 million is going to Western North Dakota. $100 million is earmarked for non-oil producing regions. And this will be split up amongst cities and counties and townships. This will allow the State Department of Transportation to bid projects right away, and that way we don't lose a construction season. As everyone who has lived in North Dakota for any period of time knows, the construction season is short. There's no time to be lost, especially when there's lots of road repair projects out there. Well, I'd like to turn our attention to the bill that was mentioned earlier. This is a bill that was introduced by Representative John Nelson. He's a Republican from Rugby, and it creates a fund that hospitals may approach this fund or try to get disbursements from this fund that have had an exceptional number of unpaid bills from oil accidents. I mean, this is a bit of an oversimplification because the bill doesn't mention oil accidents in particular, but that is the reason for the bill, is because we have medical treatment, increased demand for medical treatment in Western North Dakota because of the influx of oil industry workers, and a lot of folks, or maybe not a lot, but some folks are leaving without paying their bills, and they have no insurance, and these hospitals are having to eat this cost. Representative Nelson, could you just talk about why you introduced this bill and what it's intended to do?
I've thought of ways that we've had some tools in the past that we've been able to use for healthcare delivery type proposals, but one of the best vehicles we had for that was a Community Health Trust Fund, and with the passage of Measure 3 several years ago, the money that flowed into that account was earmarked for smoking cessation programs. So since that time, I've been looking for another vehicle. It just seems to me, given the fact that that smoking and tobacco tax, what that cost has on the healthcare system, that this was an appropriate use of a dedicated fund. So the idea was to set up a trust fund, and it's called, if this bill passes, would be the Healthcare Delivery Trust Fund. Of that, in the projection for the next biennium is nearly $58 million would flow into that account. And one of the proposals, and this it's multifaceted. There's more than just this one issue, but of that, in that trust fund, this hospital debt relief fund would draw from that. So, and the whole idea behind that is just the explosion of bad debt across all the state. It's more acute in the western part of the state, Dale, but it's occurring at record levels throughout the state. And the 36 critical access hospitals that I'm most familiar with is experiencing some serious and dealings with that. In fact, if we don't do something from the state level, I'm afraid that we're going to start losing some hospitals.
How much money are we talking about here that would be in this fund?
In the bill, we are dedicating up to $20 million in this biennium. The analysis that's been done, and this is how it would work, that debt relief part of it. We went back to pre oil boom days, and we did a 3-year rolling average of the hospital debt in the acute, the outpatient, and clinical divisions of the hospitals in the state, and in that analysis in 2006, 2007, and 2008, it was determined that 2.7% of the gross charges were attributed to bad debt. So that would be the benchmark where the hospital would assume that first 2.7%. After that, the debt relief would kick in, and it would provide a grant to those hospitals for the percentage of bad debt that they're incurring above that 2.7%. The analysis that the first analysis we saw would amount to $5.2 million in the first year of the biennium, but and all this data is collected in a cost report at the end of each calendar year, and the best guess is that it will double the second year because of what's been happening this past year. It's just exploding across the state.
So they have to eat the first 2.7% of their gross revenues in terms of bad debt?
Right. That's the and as the 36 critical access hospitals in the state are all 501c3 hospitals, so that's part of the mission of these hospitals, that if somebody comes into the emergency room, for example, it's mandated by federal law that they stabilize the patient, and then if it's appropriate for testing or admission, they do that before any conversation about repayment can be made. After they're admitted, that's the first time that they can a hospital can actually discuss repayment with them.
Representative Johnson, could you just describe to us what the bill does and what your reasons were for introducing it?
Well, thank you, Dale, and good evening, folks. What I did here in 1385 was trying to create an incentive for folks to stay clean. And I think it was going back to most everyone in the workforce has to drug test and be subject to spot test to stay employed. And I was just trying to create a program here so one would have to stay clean if you're going to participate in a program such as TANF and SNAP. Realize we may have some problems with the SNAP area, but when we put this bill together, it was to get the conversation going when we are around visiting communities and such, and this conversation comes up time and again. And so what I've done here is I see there's about 41 states that have moved similar types of legislation. 7 states have passed this type of legislation. And so I copied some of the better things from some of the states that have put this into place and practice, and realize there's still some problems with the ones that have been put into place. But right now it's a conversation, and see if this is something that can work in North Dakota. And like I said, trying to create an incentive to stay clean rather than a penalty for being dirty.
Senator Campbell, could you just explain to folks why you signed on to this bill and why you think it's significant?
Thanks, Dale. Thanks for having me. Dennis came to me 2-3 weeks ago, and it was, to me, it was an absolute no-brainer. To me, I think we've enabled people long enough. The philosophy, the culture, we've enabled people to, not just people of all income levels, not just discriminating against the poor, but anybody from farmers receiving government payments to employees, truck drivers. Our truck drivers have to undergo random drug tests. And to me, it's just an absolute, like I said before, an absolute no-brainer, common sense, that if somebody of any level has something to hide, they would probably challenge this. And I think if they have money, of anybody of any age, any occupation, can afford to have, you know, drugs or buy alcohol or something like that, then they probably shouldn't be entitled to the drugs or something that they'd fail a test in. So I was excited, and I appreciate Dennis coming, because these are some of the things that I feel, and I don't care what some people feel, maybe I'm too aggressive in voicing my opinion, but this is some of the stuff that I think I was elected to, and this is principles. I'm going to be, instead of politically correct, maybe biblically correct. This is not what God intended for us to do, to enable people to do things of this nature. So I feel very strong about this. I wasn't at the hearings. There's a lot of the detailed stuff I'm not familiar with because we were busy in the Finance and Tax Committee this morning, but I'm glad that Dennis came to me, because I'm going to stake a pretty firm stand on this.
Representative Mooney, you're a member of the House Human Services Committee. The House Human Services Committee held a hearing on this bill. Could you just describe the testimony that happened and pro and con, although we've heard plenty of pro already, and just describe for us what your own feelings are about this bill after listening to the testimony.
Sure. The testimony, we had two that came in as proponents, and that would have been Representative Johnson, and then one of the other co-sponsors of the bill was on as well. And then following that, then we had a series of people who got up and testified, all in opposition of it. And they were people from State Department, from Social Services, and just a real variety of people who deal with this on a daily basis, and all of them speaking in opposition to the bill as it's written.
And what were their reasons for opposing the bill?
I think basically it's the premise that we are, by definition, the way that the bill is written, we're presupposing that people are going to be on drugs before they get to that door to ask for help. And so I think that's the starting place, you know, guilt before any association, basically. And then a lot of discussion regarding who those people are. The discussion of, you know, single mothers, very poor people. You know, the people who are on TANF are some of our poorest people in North Dakota, in the, you know, and across the country. There was also a lot of discussion about the constitutionality of such a bill. The Fourth Amendment rights are a part of everybody's right, and this actually would go against that grain. And some of the states that have actually passed these types of laws have actually been challenged in court, and to date we only know of one that is not in litigation for that purpose of defending the Fourth Amendment rights. Another point that was brought up is there's also a presupposition that all the people who come to social services for TANF or any of the other programs that are available are simply young, and that's not the truth either. One of the growing, the fastest growing demographics for these types of programs is our 65 and older population. So there is that question, you know, do you want your grandmother, do you want your mother, do you want your father going in and having to be submitted to go through a drug test? And I think that that's a very legitimate question to ask.
Senator Klein, I wanted to just ask you, are there particular issues in your Industry, Business, and Labor Committee, of which you're the chairman, that affect financial services or that you think are particularly notable in the financial services realm?
Well, Dale, we probably didn't have any big BAMs or big BABs, which would be a big bills.
Big burgers or big bills?
And, the fact that we've gotten to a position where everybody seems to be working together well, there hasn't been a lot of issues that's come before our committee that have dealt with, in particular, the credit unions or even the banks, for that matter. It seems that we have we're in a period of time. I've been here a few sessions now that everyone is just getting along, and it's just great. So, as far as the concerns to the financial institution, I don't think we're seeing them. But I know there's been a lot of discussion. You're gonna take that up, and we've heard that all during the interim in the. And the Administrative Rules Committee as it relates to appraiser.
Ms. Holzer, could you just explain to us, please, what is the role of an appraiser in the process of getting a home mortgage loan?
Dale, what the appraiser does is his function is to determine a value for the property that we are financing based on other sales within that same area. It's an opinion that they work through looking at the comps. So that we know that the dollars that we are financing the property is worth what we're going to be borrowing out.
And why is it necessary to have a good appraisal when you're making a mortgage loan? What is the function of the appraisal?
We need to know that the collateral that we are taking is worth what we're borrowing.
So the appraiser gives you a good indication of what the property is worth, and then you know how much to loan.
Absolutely. Based on current market, he will make a determination as to what the value is.
Mr. Campbell, could you explain to us the role of the appraiser in getting a mortgage loan and what an appraiser does?
Well, the appraiser obtains sales of other properties in the same community or in the same neighborhood, if possible, that would be similar to the property that you're appraising. And then they will look at the different sales and compare them to the subject property, making adjustments for differences, and then arriving at a value estimate.
And how long a process is this?
Well, the appraisal process itself would probably take, I know you mentioned 5 or 6 a day. I think that's probably a little bit aggressive. I think most appraisers are probably figuring, because the requirements have gone up more and more, there's more and more required for an appraisal now than there used to be, say, 5, 10 years ago. But I would say you're probably looking at, 1 to maybe 3 appraisals per day if you're staying in a local market like Bismarck. But like was mentioned before, if you end up having to go to a smaller community where there isn't the data available, it just takes a lot of time, and that can you can be lucky to get one appraisal done in a day.
Senator Mather, could you tell us about the bill that I just made a very slight reference to that will offer microloans, money for microloans to folks who can use those loans to start businesses?
Yeah, glad to, Dale. Senate Bill 2349 came to us from Fauzi Adi, who is the executive director of the Immigrant Development Center, who is from Fargo. Fauzi and that organization works with new Americans. And many of these new Americans, people coming from other countries to this country, have skills. And those skills can be put to immediate use by their own business development. But often what they need is a small loan. And this concept of microloan has actually been around the country for 20 years or so. And what happens is this small loan develops into economic activity, develops into business development, develops into these new Americans paying taxes, these new Americans paying for all of the expenses that they had coming to America. In fact, these new Americans probably add more to the economy than you or I, Dale.
Mr. Thompson, do the issues presented by microlending, are they particularly complex for a bank or a credit union?
Well, I don't think so because of the size necessarily, but it might be, Senator Mather mentioned a carver or a sculptor or something like that. That's not generally the kind of business that we give a loan to, or maybe if it's an ethnic food store that we don't quite understand, that we haven't given a loan on that type of business. That I could see could increase the complexity of it because if we don't have that understanding. But otherwise, in terms of writing a business loan, I mean, you're looking at the same elements that, we are going to have, and that is the component of education. There would need to be some kind of business plan. There's got to be something, some kind of documentation that's going to explain what the idea is, how it's going to work. And if that's the case, that looks solid. We know how to make loans, and we're really good at it. We've been given small dollar loans for many, many years. We'll continue to do so. So I don't think it's going to be overly complex, and it is something that as long as we had some backing, I think we'd be really open to looking at.
Senator Mather, in the Immigrant Development Center, is this something that they do for folks that need a microloan or have an idea for a business? Do they help to kind of guide them through the bureaucracy of it?
The Immigrant Development Center does that. They also help in the education for employers on how to work with new Americans, and they help new Americans figure out what are the rules of commerce and work ethic in America. So they do that. But beyond that, the Immigrant Development Center is a place. It's a building. The goal is to have a center of many small businesses. So they will have a building. In fact, they have the building already. And then they want to rent out rooms in the building for these small businesses. And these small businesses need the microloan to begin their
their process of filling their inventory, for example. And so the Immigrant Developmental Center is a place that not only helps people, but is a place where the business can locate. And then the citizens that are interested in this kind of product can go one place and might experience Asian activities, African activities, South American activities, all in one area.
Is this fairly similar to, I mean, we have heard talk in the legislature and in the economic development community about business incubators and places of that nature. Isn't this fairly similar to this? Yeah.
Excellent word. That's basically what it is, Dale. It's an incubator for these people who have these ideas, have the drive, and they need a little bit of assistance to make it work.
You know, and I think that we'd like to really help. You know that there's 68 million under or non-banked people in the United States today, and we don't want to see these people as well fall into a group that is underbanked or unbanked and have to go to high interest rate payday lenders.
Excellent.
So we, you know, certainly like to try to help them understand the banking system in the United States and understand credit unions and what our philosophy is and what we do.
The gentleman you just heard speaking was Mr. Robbie Thompson. He's the president and CEO of the Credit Union Association of the Dakotas. We've also had with us this evening discussing a micro-lending program that's the subject of a bill that's introduced in the North Dakota Senate. We've also had Senator Tim Mathern. He's a Democrat from Fargo who has worked extensively with New Americans in Fargo and is familiar with their issues. We also have Mr. Jeff Olson, who is a vice president for advocacy for the Credit Union Association of the Dakotas. And we thank the Credit Union Association of the Dakotas for sponsoring an hour of this program. They are a principal sponsor of the legislature today, and they help present a program one night a week. And they are having their legislative social later on this week, and we certainly wish you gentlemen success in that endeavor.
Thank you.
This is Dale Wetzel with the legislature today. Thank you.